केवढ काय रावण केवढ मीठ कौन कहले से देखिए मुझे तो वर्तमान किसी कहूँ किसी भी जहाँ भी कहले
हेलो 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 देवाशीष हेलो
हेलो हाँ सर नमस्ते
इज एवरीथिंग रेडी
या
नमस्कार इज एवरीथिंग रेडी इज एवरीथिंग रेडी शुड बी स्टार्ट नाउ
यस सर वी कैन स्टार्ट
और
Kailash sir,
okay. So should we wait for Kailash sir? Kailash sir, actually, Kailash sir, he will not join today. He has some work. Okay, so he has given me the responsibility. Okay.
Okay.
Kailash sir is not joining.
Okay.
Okay, he has some work.
Okay.
Okay, let us wait for one more minute. Debasis should be start now. Debasis should be start now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay.
Am I audible, na? Am I audible?
Yes,
okay.
Sir. You are audible.
Audible.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Namaskar, everybody. We are into the 8th day of the webinar series on Western philosophy hosted by the philosophy family. Today, the webinar will be on the philosophy of George Berkeley. We have two speakers. In the first session, we have Sri Narayana Behra and In the second session, we have Sri Debasis Sadangi. We have Mrs. Nibedita Priyadarshini Madam as the moderator during the interaction session. So, welcome everybody. Respected convener and host of this webinar series, Professor Pramod Das, the coordinators Dr. Kailas Maharana and Dr. Patit Pavan Das, the event recording in charge Sri Devasis Sadangi, the speakers today Sri Narayan Behra, Sri Debasis Sadangi, and dear participants. As I said, that today both the sessions would be on the philosophy of George Berkeley. In the first session, Sri Narayan Behra will be speaking on the refutation of abstract ideas and matter. In the second session, we have Sri Debasis Sadangi, who will be speaking on the subjective idealism of Berkeley and solipsism. So, before inviting the first speaker, Sri Narayan Behra, let me introduce all of you about the academic achievements of Sri Narayan Behra. Sri Narayan Behra is presently working as assistant professor in logic and philosophy in Sassi Bhushan Rath Government Women's College, Berhampur. Sri Behra passed his master's degree in 1996 from Utkal University, Bhubaneswar. Soon, in the same year, in 1996, he qualified the UGC JRF examination and joined as research fellow in the Department of Philosophy, Utkal University. On being selected as lecturer by OPSC in 1999, he joined the prestigious SKCG Autonomous College, Parlakimendi. He served there for about 14 years and then he was transferred to Kollikot College in 2013. In 2018, he was transferred to Sassi Bhushan Rath Government Women's College, Berhampur, where he is presently working as assistant professor in logic and philosophy. Sri Narayan Behra worked on two UGC projects, one on the concept of reference, some problems and conjectures. The second project that he worked on is on Aristotle always threads a middle path. This is the second title that he worked on. He organized a seminar in SKCG Autonomous College, Parlakhemundi, in collaboration with the Department of Botany on sustainable development and its ethical aspects. So, we are very much fortunate to have Sri Narayan Behra in the philosophy family. He will be addressing on the refutation of abstract ideas and matter. May I now invite Sri Narayan Behra to deliver his lecture. Over to Sri Narayan Behra for the lecture. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone. गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल. हेलो, इज इट ऑडिबल?
हेलो
हेलो
यस
सर. ओके ओके सर, थैंक यू थैंक यू. ओम भाई और ओम सर फॉर हिज नाइस इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट मी. सच इन सच नाइस वर्ड ही प्रेजेंटेड मी बिफोर द ऑडियंस. First of all, I will congratulate Pramod sir, Kailash sir, and then Pandita Bhavan sir, and Omi for organizing such a for the faculty for us. And I congratulate the founding father of the philosophy family, professor who organized, created such a beautiful group for the lovers of we would able to exchange our views on the philosophy. What I like in this group very much that it is restricted only to philosophy, and here philosophy goes on. I will say in this word the philosophy goes on, and what matters here is philosophy, or philosophy matters here. Okay, I also thanks Devashish sir for his 10 as he takes a lot of pain in recording all the proceedings of the webinar. I think I am fortunate that I am able to speak something my views on George Berkeley. So I am indebted to the philosophy family for giving me opportunity to speak something about my understanding of George Berkeley. Now I start my presentation. It is my views on Berkeley. Okay, Berkeley was a great philosopher of early modern era and one of the member of the empiricist trio consisting of Locke, Berkeley, and Hume. He was a brilliant critic of his predecessors, particularly Descartes, Melbourne, and Locke. He defends his theory of idealism and views that reality consists only in mind. Reality consists only in mind and in their ideas. His views are found in his celebrated writings like the Treatise Concerning the Principles of Human Knowledge, or shortly it is called as Principles. It is published in 1710. And another book, A New Theory of Vision, which is published in 1709. And another one, that is Three Dialogues Between the Hylas and Philonous, which is shortly called as Dialogues, published in 1713, when he was just 28 years. So he completed all his writings when he was very young. When Berkeley read in Dalvin University, when he entered there, he found that the central philosophical interest in that university was Locke's essay concerning human understanding. Locke opposed, as my topic is given to me, the topic given to me is the reputation of the abstract ideas and the matter. I will oscillate between Locke and Berkeley. So the topic, as already Dr. Jatin Bisoi and Dr. Pragya Madam already discussed yesterday about Locke, still then I cannot complete my topic without going to without going to luck. So I have to oscillate between luck and Berkeley. Okay. So luck opposed the doctrine of innate idea of Cartesian doctrine of innate idea, and declares that the human mind at birth is a tabula rasa or a blank slate on which experience writes freely and boldly. Locke says that all our ideas come from experience. Experience is the sole source of our knowledge, and he is called, for this reason, he is called as the founder of the British empiricism. This empirical line of thought is further carried forward by Berkeley and Hume. Berkeley is related to Locke as Spinoza is related to Descartes. Berkeley accepts empiricist view of Locke, but rejects Locke's view of abstract ideas and the existence of matter as mind-independent substance. Berkeley thinks that Locke's view of the existence of the matter as a mysterious substance of which we know nothing, as already discussed in our previous two sessions, we know that the Locke says that the substance the material substance we don't know what. Okay, so this view, that is the matter as a mysterious substance of which we know nothing, opens way to skepticism. Berkeley believes that materialism is wrong because it promotes atheism and skepticism. It promotes skepticism because materialism promotes skepticism because it says that our sense mislead us to the nature of the material object. It cannot assure what is the nature of the material object, so it may mislead us. Because we don't know whether the ED exists or don't exist. We only, as a realist, Locke says that there is a material of which which creates ideas in our mind. Okay, and the materialism also promotes atheism because the material world would exist without the assistance of the God. So Berkeley wages war against skepticism and materialism. However, it is irony of fate that a philosopher whose main aim was the reputation of skepticism should himself have come to be regarded as simply a link in the chain of skeptical reasoning connecting Locke to Hume. Berkeley accepts the Locke's starting point, that is, experience is the only source of knowledge, and shows that one may arrive at a different conclusion, that is idealism, from this starting point. He agrees with Locke that our knowledge consists of ideas, either of sensory or of memory or of imagination, but concludes that the various ideas imprinted in our mind cannot exist independent of the mind which perceives them. That means the ideas cannot exist independent of mind, and thereby the substance cannot exist independent of mind. Whatever we know through the ideas. Okay. So Berkeley tried to carry forward the empiricism of Locke by reputing Locke. Here it seems too paradoxical, but this is the view that Berkeley tried to carry forward the empiricism of Locke by reputing Locke. That is to say, two fundamental mistakes of Locke, namely the assumption of the abstract general ideas or abstract ideas and the belief in the material substance which Locke believes exists independent of mind. Let us first discuss Berkeley's refutation of the abstract idea. Then we will discuss about his view on the distinction of primary and secondary quality, and then his rejection of the mind. Now I will discuss about his refutation of the abstract ideas. Berkeley's anti-obstructionism is found in the introduction of his principles, where he was of opinion that we cannot form general ideas in the way Locke suggests that by stripping the particularizing quality from the idea of the particular, then creating a new intrinsically general abstract idea. According to Locke, all the things that exist are particular. But Locke says, whatever we see are the particular things. But we frame general ideas like man, fish, tree, chair, table, etc., without which we cannot communicate our thoughts. The general ideas are applicable to all the particulars. The generality of the particulars consists only in the fact that the generality is applicable to a variety of particulars. The general ideas in their own being, as ideas of our mind, they are just as particulars as everything else that exists. It is, he says that we abstract the idea from the particular characters or by particular entities with the common character that is called a general idea, and we abstract it. The general words are different from here I would like to differentiate the general words from the proper names. The proper names, like for example, I say promoter. Promoter is referred to a particular individual, and it is the image of a particular individual being. So proper names are the image of the object which refers to only one individual object. For example, I said Jatin, my friend Jatin. Jatin only it is a image of the it is only applicable to the image of the Jatin, not to any other body. So, but the general words like man, fish, tree, etc. refers to each and every individual member of a certain class. So the general words imply the class character. Here one thing is introduced, that is the class character. So question arises, how this class character is generated? Locke believes that the general idea of man is an image of the general class character. It is an image of the general class character and is a product of the mental obstruction through this is created. The mind observes, but how this is created? Mind observes and compares several individuals of a class and finds some qualities which are common and essential, such as animality and rationality in case of man, any object common and essential quality is abstracted. Then the mind abstracts those common qualities from the individuals and put them under the name called the general idea, such as man, peace, tree, etc. The Locke states that the general idea are abstract ideas and not concrete. Locke says that the general ideas are abstract idea and they are not concrete. They have the mental existence and abstracted from the particulars and are construction of the mind. Three things he says that one is that it is abstracted from the particulars, it is created out of mind, the mental obstruction, and it has no entity in the external world, it is exists in the mind. Okay. The general ideas are presently are present only in the mind, as concept or ideas. Hence, the his theory of general idea or abstract idea is called as conceptualism. Okay, Berkeley says that it is not Locke is not justified to admit the general ideas from the empirical point of view. Berkeley is more consistent empiricist than Locke. In his principle, Berkeley says that the idea of man, take a general idea, example of a general idea, that is man. We can frame when we have a general idea of man, we can frame idea of man. When we think of man, there we don't find any general idea of man. It is either the idea of the man will be either a white man or a black man or a brown man, or it may be in another word we can say it is a tall idea of a tall man or short man or a middle sized man. Similarly, when we cannot conceive the abstract idea of man. Similar case is also happen when we are try to form the idea of the color. When we try to analyze the idea of the color, so we are always find the image of a particular. Hello. The image of a particular particular idea of color, that is either image of blue color or yellow color or red color or white color, etc. But we don't find a general idea which is devoid of all the colors and also applicable to all. We cannot find such idea. So Berkeley says that there is no general property in the particular object. General property in the particular object, no general idea, and no general idea or universal corresponding to that property. We treat the image of particular idea which representing it. So Berkeley deny this, and he says that he tried to explain it in his own way. That we treat the image of particular idea which representing in all the individuals of particular class as general idea. That is, which is a particular idea which represented in every individual of the of that class is called as general idea. He says that an idea which considered by itself is particular becomes general by being made to represent or stands for all other particular of the same class. Berkeley says that we cannot really think of abstract general ideas, of a triangle or a man or color or etc. Our idea, if we examine them, is always of a particular. For example, when we are imagine the general idea of man, we are always imagine of a particular man, not the general man. Okay, so our idea, if we examine, is always of a particular object, that is either particular triangle, in case of triangle, or particular man or particular color. The general abstract idea cannot be formed. So the Berkeley simply says that the general abstract idea cannot be formed. When we treat our idea of man, for example, so what represent in all cases of man, he says that when we treat our idea of man is representing not in one man but all the men, here we pay our attention only to the aspects of it which are common to the particular man and all other men. That is, which is common to every individual. We took that aspect and we generalized it. Okay. So, but rightly speaking, it is a particular idea. It is better to call it a representative idea rather than an abstract general idea. The idea which exists are ultimately particular ideas or the image with a content derived from the sense. Here, in case of the general idea, we cannot find the general idea, general abstract idea. When we give the general idea, it is Berkeley says that it is a particular idea which represents in every individual, and which it is a representative of every individual, and its content is devoid from the particular idea. Okay, in this way he rejects the abstract general idea. If we extend his rejection to the idea of matter as a general idea, we can reject the matter itself. The general word matter means all the material object of the world. If we separate it from the particular sensation, then there exists nothing, or it is left with nothing. So Berkeley says that Locke's belief in material substance is a result of the doctrine of abstract ideas, which is an impossible or absurd doctrine. Berkeley says that the abstract general ideas are nothing but names. Berkeley says that the abstract general ideas are nothing but names representing all the individuals of a particular class, and it is devoid of the content. The idea is devoid of the content of the particularity. So his theory is called as according to him, the general ideas are only the names. They are devoid of anything. So his theory of abstract idea is called as nominalism. This is all about his reputation of the abstract ideas. Now I will move to his distinction of his views about the distinction of primary and secondary quality, and also to the reputation of the matter. Okay, so in his principles and dialogues, he defends his view of idealism by attacking materialism. The principles and the dialogues are overflow with such arguments. Here we should know that what doctrine he is attacking, or what doctrine he is try to attack and establish his idealism. Here the materialism does not mean materialism has two meanings. If I say materialism means only matter exists, that is not the theory he wants to refute. He wants to refute the theory that the material substance exists as mind independent reality. See, materialism which he wants to reject is that the view that the matter or the material substance exists as mind independent reality. Locke's view of the matter as mind independent reality whose existence does not depend on any perceiving mind is rejected by Berkeley. Locke tried to establish his representative theory of representative realism by giving the distinction between the primary qualities and the secondary qualities. Berkeley, in his dialogues, argues most persuasively against the matter. In his dialogues, Hylas stands for the scientifically educated common sense, and Philonous stands for Berkeley, or as the spokesperson for Berkeley. And here, Berkeley's objective is to reject the materialism and establish his idealism. So he criticizes and rejects lost distinction of primary and secondary qualities. Locke says that primary qualities are those qualities that are in the object, and they are in the object itself, and they are intrinsic to the objects. They can be measured, for example, size, shape, weight, etc. They are inseparable from the object. The ideas of the primary quality resemble to the actual quality of the object. Our sense experience of them resemble the actual existing primary quality in the object. So primary qualities are inseparable, and they resemble to the primary quality of the object. So the idea is here resemble to the real quality in the object. So primary quality resemble the real object behind, as the primary quality resemble the idea of the primary quality resemble to the real primary quality of the object. So there is a reality which in which these qualities exist, in which the qualities exist, and here Locke says that these qualities are inseparable, and they don't vary from circumstance to circumstances, and they are circumstances to circumstances and subject to subject. On the other hand, he says that the color, smell, taste, etc. are the secondary qualities, are not inherent in the object. They are only the ideas of the particular perceiver or the observer. These ideas are not produced by the secondary qualities of the object. The secondary quality is not exist in the object itself. The objects don't possess these qualities, but have a power to produce in the perceiver certain sense experience. The color of an object varies considerably depending on the light and condition of the observer. For example, a colorblind person cannot see the colors properly. If we see blood, then it is normally red. But if we see through the microscope, then we find it is transparent liquid with a few dots of red. So these qualities, as they vary from person to person, Locke says that they are separable. They are separable qualities. Objects don't have them in itself. But objects have the power to produce this type of the sense perception of the secondary qualities in the observer. Okay. The Berkeley believes that Berkeley try to reject this view, and he says that there is no basis for holding the distinction between the primary qualities and the secondary qualities. Three arguments he provided. One is the secondary qualities and like color, taste, smell are inseparable from the primary qualities, shape, size, weight, etc. So here we take the example of the color and the shape. Color and the shape are inseparable. shape is simply the boundary of color. We cannot imagine one, we cannot imagine a shape without color. Similarly, we cannot imagine a color without shape. So they are dependent upon each other. For that reason, we cannot imagine one without other. That means if the object don't have one, it cannot have the other. So the object, if the object have the primary quality, it must have the secondary quality. If in other words, if it is as per Locke's wording, if the secondary quality is absent in the things in themselves, then there is no the primary quality also cannot be present in the object. So if the object don't have the secondary quality, it cannot have the primary quality. So they, as they are inseparable, we cannot say that this we cannot imagine one without other. Okay, the second argument, both primary and secondary qualities are variable. The variability which Locke says that the primary qualities are invariable, but the secondary qualities are variable. This is challenged by the Berkeley. Just as color varies from different varies from person to person, and in different condition of light and internal condition of the observer, the shape and size also vary depending on the distance of the object and the perceiver. For example, if I see near the object, then it looks larger. If I saw the object from a distance, a great distance, then it is looks smaller. So this is very natural. And similarly, another example, a coin looks round from above, but it is elliptical from an angle. Similarly, about say, if I think of mountain, it is straight. It is straight. But if I dip it in the water, then it looks bent. So the shape even it varies depending upon the condition of the observation. If variability is the basis for a quality to be primary or secondary, then all the qualities are variable and thereby denied of the object. Jodi I'm variable, if I say that variability is the on the basis of variability we divide the qualities into primary and secondary, then according to that the variability is applicable to primary quality and secondary quality, so thereby the object cannot have any of the of these qualities. Both are relative to the perceiver, so we cannot make this distinction. Locke says that the third argument is about the resemblance. The Locke says that the ideas of the primary qualities are resemble have resemblance to the same quality in the object. Berkeley says that how could we ever know our experience of the primary quality resembles those of the qualities of the object? An idea resembles nothing but another idea. Even if there is a resemblance, suppose for argument's sake, even if we admit that there is a resemblance between the idea of the primary quality and the quality itself in the object, then we cannot ever know it. We cannot know it because whenever we know, it becomes idea. We cannot know the real quality, the real primary quality. So here another thing to say that Locke admits that we know only our ideas. If we only know our ideas, then we cannot smuggle, we cannot derive something as X, something as X, which is not an idea, in order to prove that X exists to cause the idea. We cannot say that the primary qualities, which are exist in the object itself, is there to cause the idea of it. In this sense, I can say that Locke throw the dust in front of his eyes and complaining about Bija. This is like this. Berkeley says that Locke admitted that the secondary qualities are mental dependent. By the same reason, we saw that the same reason the primary qualities are also mental dependent. That means all the qualities are mind dependent, or the depends upon some perceiving mind. If we take away the qualities of a thing, then nothing remains. In this way, we prove that the qualities are neither primary nor secondary, and we cannot assign these qualities to an external entity called matter. So there is nothing which we can call as the substratum where the ideas, where the qualities exist. We cannot say this. There is only existing thing that is our ideas. Similarly, Berkeley holds that there is no mind independent substance. In this way, he says that there is no mind independent qualities nor substance. Mind independent substance, and formulate his famous empiricistic dictum, that is, essay is to perceive, or to be is to be perceived. His argument goes like this: we perceive ordinary objects like trees, book, pen, etc. First, this is the first premise. Second premise, we perceive only ideas. From this, the conclusion derived that the ordinary objects are also ideas, or the what we perceive are ideas, or the objects are ideas. So this conclusion implies his idealism, which will be taken over by Devasis sir. I will not venture into that. I am only limited my speech to the reputation of the matter. So first see that the first premise, that is, we perceive ordinary object is looks hard to deny. It is already accepted. And the second premise, that we perceive only ideas, it is also accepted by Locke. It is obviously accepted that the second premise says that we perceive ideas. The first premise, we perceive ordinary objects, and Locke says also that we perceive things through the ideas. So here we find that we immediately perceive only ideas and immediately perceive the ordinary objects. So this view is Locke's representational theory of perception, where we perceive the material object through the perceiving ideas. The ideas represent the external material object and allow us to perceive them. The ideas represent the external object according to Locke, allow us to perceive them. Berkeley, in his principles, raises questions this view. He says that what allows an idea to represent the material object? What allows? Because we don't know on the idea represent whether there is a mind independent substance or not, we don't know. The representational view of law would say that the idea resembles the material object. Idea resembles the material object, but Berkeley argues that this supposed resemblance is nonsensical, and the idea can only be, already I discussed it, only be compared to another idea. He says that two things cannot be said to be like or unlike till they have been compared. In order to compare, we should know two things, but we cannot know the unperceived mental independent substance. As mind cannot can compare nothing but its own idea, mind can compare only its ideas. It cannot compare its idea with the mental independent substance. So we cannot say there is a resemblance between them. So the mind cannot can compare nothing but its own ideas, because it cannot know non-ideal mind independent material object. So the representationalist cannot assert the resemblance because resemblance between the idea and non-ideal mind independent material object. Berkeley, in his Principles and Dialogues, argues that matter at best is completely an empty idea. It is completely an empty idea. It has nothing. If we say that there is no material object, then question arises: how can we explain our ideas? Berkeley says, even if we admit the materialistic view the existence of the matter, it cannot help us to explain the occurrence of the idea. The dualism of mind and body, as already discussed in the Descartes, mind is a different substance, and body is a different substance. They are totally different qualities. So the dualism of the mind and body did not help us to explain the origin of the idea. That is, how can your question arise? How can one substance causally affect another substance of the fundamental, which are fundamentally different in qualities? If we assume the Cartesian theory, then we know that the mind is non-special, and the body is special, and they cannot interact. The problem arises there. So, even if we accept the existence of the matter, which is impossible to accept, similarly, for the argument's sake, as to accept Kolevi, we cannot find that how they create the ideas in our mind. His master argument is that we cannot actually conceive of the mind independent substance. Mind independent substance cannot be conceived. Berkeley says that our ideas can never represent unconceivedness. It cannot represent unconceivedness because we have never and could never experience the unconceivedness of anything. Unconceived object cannot be known to us. Whenever we try to conceive it, or we try to know it, then it becomes perceived or conceived. So there cannot be our view cannot go beyond the perceived notions. So how can we say that there is a unconceived mind independent substance? So we cannot have unperceived substance which is mind independent. So the idea of matter is an unconceived idea is meaningless and impossible idea. It is a meaningless idea and also an impossible idea. So Berkeley maintains the Berkeley in this way try to refute the lost view about the abstract ideas, and he maintains that the division of the primary and secondary quality distinction cannot be accepted. The idea of having an unperceived mind independent substance is impossible. He admits that whatever we know is we know through our ideas and our mind. So he admits only ideas and the perceiving minds. He admits the existence of this the existence of ideas and the perceiving mind. He says that nothing exists except mind and their ideas. This is all about his theory of reputation of abstract ideas and reputation of the on perceived mind independent substance. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Sri Narayan Behera, for nicely presenting Berkeley's refutation of abstract ideas and matter. I think the participants might have been benefited by your exposition on the subject. Now you see, we have to take the question and answer session. We have with us Nibedita Priyadarshini Madam, Assistant Professor in SPM Autonomous College, Jagatsinghpur. She will take the interaction session. So I request Madam Nibedita Priyadarshini to carry on the interaction session. Please check the questions in the chat box and put those questions before the speaker for his comments and observations.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. First of all, pranam to all the teachers of the philosophy family, and very much thankful to the teachers for giving me this opportunity to be a part of this intellectual session. I must say this is a good initiative for the students as well as for the academician, and it is a stage through which we can learn something, and we can it is a process of learning, I can say. So thank you very much, sir. I must thank to Professor Dr. Narayan Behera for your brief and clear presentation. I hope this will be helpful for the students. Now we'll proceed for the question answer session. The first question is by Nanda Bose. He wants to know the distinction between primary quality and the secondary quality was prevalent in the scientific world. So does Berkeley going against the scientific belief?
I don't think so, but whatever the arguments given by our subjective idealist Berkeley, I think they are very very observing, and these arguments proves that we cannot arbitrarily on the basis of loss distinction, we cannot say this quality as primary or that quality is secondary. First thing. Second thing, that the primary quality which they are speaking that it exists in the object itself is not acceptable to Berkeley. So I don't think the Berkeley goes against the scientific belief, but his theory is not accepting this division.
Okay, thank you, sir. The same, another question is also asked by Nandagu, sir. Accepting a material substance over and above ideas is commonsensical, and it is a logical substance for Locke, and for Berkeley, it is empiricism. Whatever we do not get in example, in experience, will not be admitted. Do you see it cross-purpose argument?
I am just going through the question. Accepting,
yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll repeat the question
material
again.
Substance.
Accepting a material
substance. Yes,
yes, sir.
A substance over and above the ideas is commonsensical, and it is a logical substance of the law. For Berkeley, it is empiricism. Whatever we don't get the experience will not be admitted. We see the cross purpose. No, I don't think so, because Berkeley is a very very consistent with his empiricism. When we don't know whatever there exists or not, we see it is through our ideas and the and our we cannot see. So for that reason he in his dialogues between the Hylas and Philonous employ Hylas as the common the scientifically common sense scientifically educated common sense, and himself as the idealist or Philonous, and he tried to the empiricism, not to go beyond the empiricism, which is common sense. Okay, that is my answer.
Okay, thank you, sir. The next question is by Pragya Daskanungo. It is about the both Locke and Berkeley have their views on general idea. Why then Lockean view is called conceptualistic, whereas that of Berkeley is called nominalistic?
You see, Locke's view of abstract idea, he said that there is a common quality. There is a common quality which is present everywhere, and it is obstructed by the mind, and it is a concept. For that reason, it is called as, and it is a work of the mind. For that reason, it is called as conceptualistic view. And as already I discussed, that the abstract idea, according to the general idea, according to the according to Berkeley, is only a name. It is not a creation of the mind. It is a particular quality which exists in a particular individual of that sort. It is just a name. It has nothing more than that. For that reason, it is called as a nominalism.
Okay, thank you, sir. The next question is also by, yes, Pragyan Askunungo. There are two statements. Whatever is known is ideas, and whatever is ideas. Berkeley proves the first. Does he prove the second?
Yes, by Berkeley, the past, whatever we know is ideas. This is also accepted by the founder of the empiricism, is Locke. Locke accept this view, but whatever what Berkeley try to accept is the second one. From the I already explained it in the argument that the first premise is just a minute. First premise is we perceive ordinary objects like tree, book, pen, pen, pencil, etc. We perceive only ideas. That is whatever we know is ideas. So the conclusion he derived is only whatever is ideas. Or in order to be is to be perceived. In order to be is to be perceived. That is essayist perceive, which is his positive contribution to the philosophy. That is subjective idealism, which will be discussed by Debashish sir in the next session. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, sir. The next question is by Sasmita Biswait. It is about the distinction between sensationism and nominalism.
Sensationalism and nominalism. Sensationalism is a form of empiricism where sensation is given the importance, but nominalism is the view about the general ideas. Where Berkeley says that there is no universal ideas. It is only a name. It cannot be abstraction of the qualities or abstraction of the particular quality, a general quality which exists in every individual. Okay. So sensationalism is a theory which gives importance to the perception, and it is different from nominalism. Hello.
Okay, the next question is by Ratnakar Gajendra sir. Berkeley says that matter is not perceived. The existence of matter is not based on inference. The existence of matter is mental. Please explain, is he justified in doing so?
Oh, sir, namaskar. But sir, I think Berkeley being a true empiricist to its true spirit, I think he is justified. He did not want to venture beyond whatever they are beyond our experience. Whether there is or not, that is different thing. But what we know is only our ideas and the spirit. So in that sense, he is justified in doing so. This is my personal opinion.
Okay, thank you, sir. This will be the last question, I think. Rinki Mahalik has asked, according to Berkeley, both qualities of a substance vary from person to person. How can we define a particular substance? What is the identity of a substance?
Berkeley, both qualities of substance vary from person to person. How can we define particular substance? This will be taken care of by the positive view of positive theory, that is subjective idealism of Berkeley by our Debashish sir. Rinki will be clarified in that session. Okay, it will take some time. For that reason, I will not venture to that thing.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another question has came by Nanda Ghosh. How can Berkeley admit God if he is so consistent in his empiricism?
Berkeley admits God as a universal mind, because if he will not admit such a spiritual substance, then he cannot explain about the about the presence of the order in the world. For example, when I see before me there is a mobile phone, but when I suddenly close my eyes, I am not perceiving it. So in order to give the perpetual existence to the perceiving to the ideas of the substance, perceiving substances, he gives rise to the concept of God.
Okay, sir.
I think hello. I think it is his necessity. Necessity. I think so.
Okay, thank you, sir. I have skipped one of the question asked by Manoswini Patnaik. She wants to know how materialism promotes skepticism. Please clarify with concrete examples.
Okay, yes, I see that question of Manoswini Patnaik. Yes, when materialism, I said two things in the introduction, that is the materialism is wrong. Berkeley thinks that materialism is wrong because it promotes atheism and skepticism. Skepticism because materialism implies that our sense mislead us to the nature, about the nature of the material object. Whether the material object is there, Locke says that the material, Locke being a representationalist realist, he says that there are some material object of which we don't know anything. So when we don't know anything, that means there are something which is always doubtful. But we cannot know anything. So in this way, it gives rise to skepticism. Hello, and it gives rise to also atheism because materialism admits that there are some material world or the substance or material substance which exist without the assistance of God. For that reason, Berkeley tried to refute this view. Okay.
I think this is all about the questions answer. Okay, thank you, sir, for all your answers. Now we will proceed for the second presentation. It is by Mr. Devasis Sarangi, and Dr. K.O.M. Narayan sir will introduce the speaker. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, madam. Madam Nivedita Pradarshini, for nicely carrying on the question and answer session. Now I see Dr. Kolasundar Maharana sir is there with us. So I request him to introduce. Kolas Maharana sir is present with us. I request him to introduce Debashis Tarangi and also.
Sir, just a minute. Huh. Thank you all for giving me opportunity. It is a nice opportunity to interact with thank you Mumbai and other organizing members. Okay sir.
Thank you Sri Narayan Behera for nicely presenting yourself and also responding to the questions. Now I request Dr. Kailas Mahana sir to introduce Debashis Sarangi and also invite him to present his lecture. I see Kailas Mahana sir is present with us. I request him to carry on this session further. Is he here? Anyway, I don't find him. Okay, I don't find him. I see no response from him. So I take this for myself to introduce the speaker of the next session. We have Debasis Sadangi in the second session on the philosophy of George Berkeley. He will be speaking on the subjective idealism of Berkeley and solipsism that he arrived at. So if I look into the profile of Debasis Sadangi, I find that he is serving as a lecturer in LN Mahavidyalaya, Jamuli, Baleswar. He is also a PhD scholar working on the Buddhist theory of embodied cognition in IIT ISM Dhanbad. So he is both active in his teaching work and also his research and is in his research. So if we look into him, I find that he has passed his master's degree from Utkal from Banaras Hindu University in 2015. So definitely since Banaras Hindu University is very much popular for Indian philosophy, and what I see in his profile that he has a great affinity for Buddhist philosophy, because many of the research articles that he has published are on Buddhist philosophy and most more on Dharmakirti. Okay, so he's working a lot on Dharmakirti. So his research areas include, he says, it is on Indian logic and epistemology, and also he is much interested in the philosophy of mind and cognition. So he got Bhavananda Datta Memorial Essay Award by the Indian Philosophical Congress in 2015. He was the central sectors. He was getting the scholarship from central sector scheme from 2010 to 15. From 2016 to 19, he was teaching assistant in IIT ISM Dhanbad. So I also see in Debasis Sadangi that he has participated in a number of seminars and workshops. So and also he has participated in one refresher course. So I see that in Debasis that he is a teacher and also a researcher and lot of interest in Indian logic. Now today we have him to speak on the philosophy of George Berkeley, especially on the subjective idealism and solipsism. So I request Sri Debasis Sadangi to present his lecture. Over to Sri Debasis Sadangi.
Thank you very much, sir, for your kind words, and my namaskar to all. First of all, I want to express my thanks and gratitude to the convener of this philosophy family, Promoter, coordinators, K.O. Narayan Rao sir, Kailas sir, and Patit Pavan Das sir, and all the teachers, scholars, and students, and my friends. So thank you very much for giving me a chance to share something with you. So I will present something on subjective idealism and solipsism. Before that, since last few days, we have observed from pre-Socratic philosophy to Socratic philosophy and post-Socratic philosophy, then some of the part of medieval philosophy and also modern philosophy from Descartes to some part of Berkeley. So we see here that the development of the ideas from the pre-Socratic period to Socratic period and the modern period, how the ideas are developing from that day to this day. So ideas are, this is the development of the ideas, I'll say, rather than the history of philosophy. So what is the job of a philosopher? So what will a philosopher do? What will a philosopher search? The job of a philosopher, as remarked by Krishnachandra Bhattacharya, is to search for the self-evident, to provide the self-evident elaboration of the self-evident, the bare truth. So everybody in their own way tries to discover or try to present the truth. So in that way, many philosophers come, and now we have reached to Berkeley. So Berkeley is famously known for his subjective idealism, refutes the materialism. Materialism is the belief that matter only exists. There is no assistance of God in this idea. So what is subjective idealism? Subjective idealism is a theory that external world does not have real existence independent of perceiving minds. Berkeley calls his position as immaterialism rather than idealism. Berkeley rejects materialism because it promotes skepticism and atheism. My co-speaker Narayan Behera sir has already told about this, so I'll not repeat all these things. I'll just say and come to my main part. So skepticism, because our senses mislead us to the nature of the material things, and atheism, because a materialist believes material world can exist without the concept of God. So what is Berkeley's project? So the Berkeley's project of immaterialism implies three things. First is refutation of material substratum, refutation of the distinction between primary and secondary qualities, refutation of abstract ideas. Again, the first one, refutation of material substratum, implies material substances are combination of sensible qualities. Second, ideas we perceive are thing in themselves. There is nothing beyond sensation. Every reality is psychic. That's why he is told that assist percipi, to be is to be perceived. So this is the whole idea, the whole project of Berkeley, to refute materialism and to establish immaterialism. In order to that, he has refuted his previous philosophers who have annihilated materialism. Actually, Berkeley was a bishop, and at that time the scientific temperament was high, and everybody used to believe that only matter only exists, or material thing is the only, there is no assistance of God, or God has no role in the world. So Berkeley tries to establish his immaterialism. So he goes to subjective idealism, and he speaks about subjective idealism and solipsism. Then what is subjective idealism? The word idealism has not certain a particular definition of idealism. Idealism has been used in different philosophies in different contexts. So in Berkeley has used in one sense, and in case of Plato the idealism is different in sense. In case of Kant, suppose in transcendental idealism, the word idealism has different meaning. And here subjective idealism, as I have already told you, that everything is mind dependent. If everything is mind dependent, then does it mean that my mind only exists? Is it only the thing that my mind only exists, or other mind also exists? So then the next question is, what about the nature or world if I cease to exist? If I will not be there, then who will perceive this world? So these charges leads to the solipsism. Solipsism means my mind only exists. So in order to in order to avoid the solipsistic charge, Berkeley's response all this question, and by introducing God, Berkeley resolves the threat of solipsism. If finite minds cease to exist, the world will exist in eternal mind, the mind of God. If my mind cannot perceive something, then there are other mind who will perceive. If other mind cannot perceive, then the eternal God will perceive them. So this theory, the subjective idealism, criticized in many ways by many philosophers, but most eminent them and most chief among them is Moore, who criticized Berkeley's subjective idealism as insufficient analysis. Perception involves two things: the act of perceiving and the object perceived. The sensation blue includes the seeing blue and the sensed blue. Here, the seeing act is mental, but sensed blue exists in its own and is non-mental. So Moore refuted his Berkeley's philosophy in this way. So in the second part, this is all about the subjective idealism. Sir has already discussed about, and I have just reread them and put in the argumentative format. So in the second part, we'll compare it with the Indian philosophical tradition. How Indian philosophical tradition sees the subjective idealism, and what kind of answer we there. And the comparative approach of Indian idealism and Western idealism, Berkeley's subjective idealism. So the famous idealist of the of Indian, from the Indian philosophy, is Yogacara Vijnanavada. Yogacara Vijnanavada claims that the consciousness only exists, or mind only exists, just like Berkeley. So as we know, the development of Buddhism comprises three different phases, namely the early realistic phase and dualistic, the middle critical and negativistic, the latter idealistic phase, the Yogacara Buddhism. So there are the Abhidharmika philosophy, which is realistic, the Madhyamika Shunyavada, which is...
Hello,
is there any problem? Yeah, so there are Madhyamika philosophy, whose philosophy is known as critical, and Yogacara Vijnanavada, whose philosophy is known as the idealistic. So the suppose if you look at this criticism of Moore, so how will a idealist reply to this answer? So if we see the Indian, from the Indian philosophical tradition, there is an argument from the Yogacara Buddhist tradition that the Sohopalambaniyama, or refutation of realism by the idealist. But the cases in case of Buddhist philosophy and in the cases of Western philosophy are different. Though they are refuting the realist, for them the realist are the previous philosophers like Locke and Descartes. But for the Yogacara Buddhism, their Purvapaksha is always Nyaya philosophy or the Sautantrika philosophy. Those were realist. Anyway, so how they will answer this question, that the blue and the consciousness of blue are identical. The blue and the consciousness of blue are identical. They are not different. Sohopalambha niyamat veda nila tadiyah. The blue and the consciousness of blue are not different. For the Yogacara, consciousness is the sole reality. The so-called empirical world is only a system of ideas. The object is only apparent. It is just like the Berkeley sense, and is really identical with its cognition. Two, content and cognition are invariably perceived together and are therefore identical. If the content is different from cognition, it should have been capable of being perceived apart from the latter. Difference presupposes separateness or availability separately, which is lacking here. The realist, however, maintained the independence of the content known. Conscious for the realist is like light, whose function is to reveal the object, but not to affect it in any other way. Perception is ontologically neutral for the realist. If to be perceived implied also to be altered, we could not say that we perceive the same object we perceived before. The content would have changed in the process of being known. If the modification were only partial, how are we going to distinguish the two parts, one of which remains unaltered and other is modified? Being perceived is only an accident in the life of the object. It is perceived but need not be perceived. There is an absolute identity of the object in its two states, first unperceived and then perceived. But according to the Yogacara school of Buddhism, knowledge is not a mere discovery of something that already exists, an unacceptable proposition, but is creative. It creates and projects its own content. Consciousness and its object are not two different things at all. There is no blue, but only the idea of blue. The essay of blue is its perceiving. The essay of blue is its perceiving. So the blue and the consciousness of blue are not different, but are identical. So how the Buddhists are representing their idealism? So first, there are no things, artha. There are no things, artha. We know about the artha kriya karitva theory that they said in Pramanavartika Dharma Kirti said, artha kriya karitvam yat tat atra paramartha sat, that which is causal efficacy, that is only the transcendental real, means by the name of water, it cannot quench our thirst. By only naming the fire, it cannot burn us. So if someone burns, then it must be called fire. If someone quench our thirst, then it must be dealt as water. So only minds or chitta and mental quality, chaitas, exist. So, vigyamti matra san. Consciousness only exists. Basubandhu enumerated this theory in his famous vigyamti matra siddhi. So, consciousness, vijnana, arises in the appearance of things, sentient beings, self or Atman and ideas, vigyamti. Its external object, artha, does not exist, and because of the non-existence of the eternal object, mind itself is false, asat. This is said in the Madhyanta Vibhaga, Lakshana Paricheda, Sloka number 3. What is the meaning of this thing that the consciousness arises in the appearance of things, sentient beings, self and ideas, vijnanti, its external object, artha, does not exist, and because of the non-existence of the eternal object, mind itself is false or asat. So in the first verse of the Madhyanta Vibhaga Shastra, Lakshana Paricheda, is saying that abhuta parikalpasti dvayam tatra na vidyate sunyata vidyate tatra tasyam api sa vidyate. False ideation or abhuta parikalpa exist. Duality does not exist in it. However, emptiness, sunyata, does exist in the false ideation. The false ideation also exists in emptiness. So the absolutism accepted by Berkeley is not in the same sense accepted by the Buddhist. These are accepted in two different sense. So here, there the absolute means the sunyata, and in the case of Berkeley, it is the God. So in Buddhism, there is no concept of God. Lastly, is like the subjective idealist. They are giving the three nature of the self in his Vasubandhu's famous three swabhava nirdesha. The three nature of things are the parikalpita, paratantra, and parinispanna. Parikalpita means fabricated, paratantra means dependent, and parinispanna means perfected. The first two, parikalpita and paratantra, are related to samvritsat or conventional reality. In Sankara's sense, you can say the vyavaharika satta, and perfected or parinispanna, perfected, is related with the paramarthika sat or transcendental reality. So the wise understand in depth the three natures. What appears is the dependent, how it appears is the fabricated. So what appears is the dependent nature, how it appears is the fabricated nature. Because of being dependent on condition, because of being only fabrication. In the second line, he's saying the eternal non-existence of the appearance as it appears, that is known to be perfected nature, because of being always the same. The third argument he is giving, what appears there? The unreal fabrication. How does it appear? As a dual self, what is its non-existence, that by which the non-dual reality is there? So in that case, we can say that, like if we go to the previous slide, that Berkeley's idealism, that Berkeley resolves the threat of solipsism by introducing the concept of God, by advancing the sunyata theory. They also avoid the solipsistic theory, and other thing, if we look the arguments here and we compare with this slide, then you can find this similarity, and a little bit of difference is of course there, but the form of idealism, both in Indian Buddhist philosophy and Berkeley's, are not different. Professor Ashok Kumar Chatterjee has written on this regards a Buddhist theory of idealism in his famous book. So idealism, both in East and West, goes in its same argumentative way. This is all about the subjective idealism, both in the Berkeley's philosophy and in Buddhist idealism. So these are the references of the books. So thank you for patience hearing.
Thank you, Debasis Sarangi, for not only explaining Berkeley's subjective idealism and solipsism, but also interlinking it with the Buddhist philosophy. As I said earlier, that you are working on Buddhist philosophy, and you have tried to relate this with the Buddhist ideas. So it's a great effort to bring about the comparison between the Western and the Eastern trends. So thank you for your nice presentation. Now over to Mrs. Nivedita Priyadarshini to carry on the question and answer session. Please take the questions in the chat box and put those questions before the speaker. Over to
Nivedita. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Devasis, sir, for your nice presentation. The first question is asked by Pratita Bhavan, sir. It is about a small query. Can we really brand Buddhism as idealistic philosophy?
Yeah, of course. Because when we see these things, that everything is mind dependent, as I have already said, that when we are talking about the Vijnanavada, so if you take any of the Yogacara philosophers, be it Vasubandhu, be it Dharmakirti, and be it any of the Yogacara philosophers, they are the idealist in itself. And I have also presented some of the arguments for that, like the three Swabhava, and also the difference between the absolutism in Berkeley sense and the different sense presented in Yogacara philosophy.
Okay, thank you. Another question is by Nanda Ghosa. In Buddhism, it is pro-vow, waves-like, but in Berkeley case, how idealism be discussed? If we take into consideration ex nihilo nihil fit.
See, it is means that they have also categorical consciousness. There are three kinds of consciousness they have discussed. That is the alaya vijnana, pravritti vijnana, and also mano vijnana. So alaya vijnana means the storehouse of the consciousness. So though there everything is in a state of flux, but This is not that alaya vijnana is permanent. Alaya vijnana is also changing, but this is the storehouse of the consciousness. So this is not the case that ex nihilo nihil fit.
Okay. This is also by Patita Bhavan sir. Repeat of this previous question. What about the views of Theravadins regarding this?
Sorry, sir. Actually, I don't know. I have not much reading from the Theravada Buddhist side. I have not read the Pali Buddhist side, only the Sanskrit Buddhist side. Sanskrit Buddhism means the Mahayana Buddhism. I'm sorry for that. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, sir. This is by Manaswini Patnaik. Sir, what is
Three Swabhava Nirdesa is the magnum opus of Basavandhu's work. Actually, Basavandhu has written this text, Three Swabhava, Parikalpita, Paratantra, and Parinispanna. The world is fabricated, imagined, Parikalpita, Paratantra, it is dependent, and Parinispanna.
Okay. Thank you, sir. The next question is by Ratnakar Gajendra, sir. Can you explain the distinction between human and divine perception?
Yeah, there are four kinds of perception categorized by the Yogacara Buddhist. One is Indriya Pratyaksha, another one is the Manasa Pratyaksha, third one is the Swasambedana, and the fourth one is the Yogic perception. The yogis are normally treated as in the Indian philosophy, just like the Nyaya also, that they are Trikaladarshi. They can perceive all the past, present, and future. So through the yogic power, they have acquired some supernatural like power. So they have enriched their consciousness. That's why they can know past, present, and future.
Okay, sir. Another question is by Rasmi Prabha Mahanti, ma'am.
Yeah, I'm seeing
this. Is Berkeley a solipsist, and what is the solipsist view of self?
No, solipsism is the view that my mind only exists, or myself only exists, but this is not the Berkeley's position. Berkeley has refuted these things by accepting the concept of God, the concept of absolute. So it is not possible that Berkeley is accepting this theory. Yeah.
Next question is by Amrita Halder, ma'am. She asked, if Berkeley is free from solipsism, so what is the position of God in his philosophy?
So he told that to be is to be perceived. So to be means if I will not perceive, then who will perceive? If I cease to exist, then who will perceive this thing? Then he told that the other mind will perceive. Then if other mind will not be there, if nobody perceives, then he told that the internal thing or the God will perceive.
The next question is also by Patita Bhavan, sir. Who is Purvapaksha for Buddhist idealism?
Purvapaksha, of course, the Nyaya realist and in some time and sometime the Sautantrika. Sautantrika and Vaibhasika, both the Theravada, because they are realist in their position. Sautantrika basically, Nyaya and Sautantrika. Basically Nyaya and sometimes Sautantrika also.
Okay. Another question is by Manoj Trini Patnaik. Is solipsism denies other existence?
Denies other existence. Mind means mental, like, psychological, like, other psychological existence.
Okay, sir. The next question is by Antaryami Dixit. If there is no physical object outside the mind, then how is the hallucinatory or illusory experiences different from the real experiences?
See, I have to understand, if there is no physical object outside the mind. Then how is the hallucinatory or illusory experiences differ from the real experiences? See, in case of hallucination or illusion, this is not the real experience, right? So there, in case of some defects in the indriyas, or in case of the suppose they have, the Buddhist have given an example, when you are going in a boat, you see the trees are moving, but really the trees are not moving, you are moving, but the thing is that you are not seeing in the exact way. That's why they appear to you as illusion. So the illusory is an appearance only. So we have to not to go by the appearance only. So that's why, you know, we have to only focus on the, not on the external object, but the ideas itself, the true ideas.
Okay, sir. Thank you. This is from Pramod Kumar Das. He wants that you give a concluding remark on Berkeley's philosophy without referring to Buddhism.
Yeah. So, if we go to these slides, then yeah, Berkeley's philosophy, actually, Judge Berkeley was bishop of the Ceylon. Was one of the great philosophers of the early modern period, was a brilliant critic of his predecessors like Descartes and Locke. He was a talented metaphysician, famous for defending the idealism, that is, the view that reality consists exclusively of mind and their ideas. Berkeley's system, while it strike many as a counterintuitive, is strong and flexible enough to counter most objects. Sir has already told in the previous lecture, his most famous work are the treatise concerning the principles of human knowledge and the three dialogues between Hylas and the Philonous. They are beautifully written and defense by Berkeley, and most famously, Berkeley's materialism made him famous. Means Berkeley's immaterialism is the unique idea which he gives to the idea, one step in the ideas of philosophy. she proclaimed that one thing I know, I am not guilty of. I do not pin my faith on the sleeves of any great man. I act not out of prejudices and presupposition. I do not adhere to any opinion because it is an old one, a received one, a fashionable one, or one that I have spent much time in the study and cultivation. In this, if we look at these things, then we may see that how he is passionate about his philosophy, his idea, that this is the uniqueness, the brilliancy of his philosophy. Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for your clear explanation. The next question is by Rasmi Prabha Mahanti. According to solipsism, self is psychological or empirical?
Psychological.
Okay. The next question is by Dr. Nrisingha Charan Samantharaya, sir. If ultimately God is there, who perceived everything which one cannot, how they Berkeley deny matter? If ultimately God is there, who perceived everything which one can't, this will be the first question, I think. Then the next question, how then Berkeley deny matter? I think he has asked two questions.
Okay, I understand now. Actually, God is the, means he is the eternal thing, means he is perceiving. The argument was in this way that that if I will cease to exist, everything depend mind dependent, or everything is immaterial, depends on my on the ideas. If my mind ceases to exist, if my mind will not perceive it, then who will perceive? Then the argument follows that the other mind will perceive it. If there will be, if the other mind also will not perceive this, then he gives an example that suppose in a jungle, in a forest, the leaves falls, and suppose so who will see? I am not seeing. The other people are also not seeing in the deep forest. So who is seeing there? Then Berkeley replies that God is seeing there. God is seeing there. So in that way, he established the absolute in this way that he perceives everything. So in order to avoid the solipsism, and in order to avoid all these kinds of puzzles, he finally accepted the concept of God. Actually, when Berkeley asked are you in pain? So he always replied that no. I am in the idea of pain. So, are you seeing something? Then he replies, no, I am just, there is the idea of things. Always he puts that the core idea is the main theme of the Berkeley's philosophy. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I think this is all about the questions and answer session. Thank you for your explanation and your presentation, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Dr. K. Om Narayan, sir, will I end the session here?
Actually, I want to tell something that what should be the method of philosophy? What should be the method of philosophy? So in this case, I want to refer Dayakrishna, who always enumerated the Sambada method. The Sambada and Swaraja, this will be the method of philosophy. Means through Sambada, the dialogues between the tradition, dialogue between East and West, and Swaraja means you put your ideas and dialogues between the separate traditions. This will embrace the philosophy. And I also appreciate, I accept this idea of Dayakrishna, that the Sambada method or Sambada and Swaraj method are the only methods in philosophy which can actually enrich our traditional philosophy like Indian philosophy. So it is both from the East-West comparative philosophy or East-West collaborative philosophy. I think everybody knows about workplace philosophy. That's why I tried that Buddhism should be there. People also should know about, student also should know about the Buddhist idealist. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir, for giving me a chance here. Thank you, Nivarita madam. Thank you, Narayan Behra sir, K.M. Narayan Rao sir, Patit Pawan sir, Kailash sir, and Pramod sir for giving me a chance to share my views. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful
day. Thank you so much. Now we are at the end of the session. Sir, Kailash sir, will I end the session by giving a vote of thanks?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, sir. I must give my vote of thanks to both the speakers, Dr. Narayan Behra and Mr. Devasis Sarangi, for their brilliant presentation. I must be thankful to our coordinator, Dr. K.O. Narayan, sir, as well as Dr. Kailash Chandra Maharana, sir, for his involvement in coordinating the session. And I must be thankful to Pramod sir, Patit Bhavan sir, and Devasi Sharani sir for your organizing such a beautiful platform to learn. Thank you. And also, I must give my vote of thanks to the students who are participating in this session. Thank you, sir. Thank you all. And the session is now ended.
Thank you so much, Shaw.